Hello everybody, Michael here for Tactica Imperialis with a very special Warhammer 40k battle report. This is probably more of a battle report for inexperienced slash complete noobs to 40k than it is for the most experienced players, because it may make some experienced players facepalm. So what I'm going to be doing today is I'm going to be doing a teaching 40k battle report. I'm going to be playing a 750 points game, which is a reasonably small size game of Orks versus Orks. It's a perfect mirror match. So I'm going to be playing exactly the same list as my opponent. That way, my opponent will be able to hopefully learn a few things from how I would use the army, because I'm quite experienced with 40k and with Orks in particular. And that way, as much as he's learning, you guys can learn at the same time. And it will also allow you to maybe spot a few, I'm not going to say pitfalls that a new player might fall into, but a few things you might want to learn. So my opponent today is Ben. He is one of the inhabitants of a nearby flat in our accommodation block. And he has never played 40k before. He's completely new. I haven't even shown him the Orc Codex yet. I haven't shown him the rulebook. I haven't shown him anything. We're just going to be playing this completely by ear. So, like I say, if you are new and you want to learn, this is probably the place to start. With that said, I'll go through the armies, and then we'll get on with the game. Okay, so here is the 750-point Orc army that both Ben and I will be using today. So, I'm going to work from left to right, maybe not the best order. So, on this side, we have 10 Gretchen. These are your very, very, very basic troopers. They are terribly statted, come with weak guns, but they are very, very cheap. And they're led by an Orc Runt Herd who is designed to keep them in line in the lore. Moving along, we have a Weird Boy. He is a shamanic psycho type of character who will cast spells, or psychic powers, I should say, to do damage or possibly buff nearby models. Leading the two armies, we have a war boss in mega armor with a boss pole to help keep units in line, and a shooter crossed with a scorcher, which is a one-use flamethrower. He also has a power claw, which makes him much more powerful in combat, makes him strength 10, and he has a 2+ save, but he cannot do something called a run move. In front of him, we have a small unit of Orc knobs. There are two big choppers, which are slightly stronger and a little bit better at getting through armor. One normal guy with a pistol and close combat weapon, slugger and chopper, and then a leader for the squad with a slugger and a power claw, which is the same weapon as the war boss has. Not as effective because his base strength is lower. We then have two mini dreadnoughts called killer cans. This one has a scorcher or a flamethrower. It's exactly the same weapon as the war boss has, except this one is multiple use rather than just one use only, and has a can claw, and it is reasonably lightly armored by most vehicle standards. His other killer can, which is a separate unit in this game, I can squad them up, but I've chosen not to, is armed with a Grotzuka, which is just a giant scrap launcher that launches a small template of scrap at the enemy. We have three Warbikers. These guys move very, very quickly and have a lot of shots for their points, and they are also led by a knob with a power claw. Then moving along, basic troops, we have 10 Slugger Boys. These are the most basic of Orcs in the list, and they are just in heavy armor. So they have a slightly better armor save than usual. They just have a pistol and close combat weapon, and they're also, of course, led by a knob with a power claw who is just here. He does not have a boss pole, despite the fact that the model is slightly models to represent that. And finally, we have 10 Shooter Boys, who do not wear the heavy armor that is synonymous with the Slugger Boys. They also include a big shooter to give them a little bit more anti-infantry firepower. This list is exactly the same. There are a couple of proxies, though, which I'd probably point that out. That is an Orc Looter, but I'm using him as a Shooter Boy. That is not a Runt Herd. I'm conscious of that. And I'm having to proxy my Big Mech with Custom Force Field to be the second Weird Boy because I haven't got a second Weird Boy yet. In terms of the killer cans, this one will have a Scorcher, this one will have a Grotzuka. Everything else is pretty much what you see is what you get, which is what I mean by WYSIWYG. We will probably redeploy slightly just because this is not obviously an optimal deployment. We need to deploy characters inside units if you want to do that, and then we will play the game. Okay, deployment. So I've gone on deployed first. I put my bikers on this left-hand side with the Shooter Boys. The Gretchen are behind the Warboss and the Knobs. The Knobs are wearing heavy armor, just like the boys, for a 4+ save. I forgot to mention that. My flamethrower killer can with the little mini dreadnought is in the middle. I then have the Weird Boy and the Slugger Boys. And then the Grotzuka blunderbuss killer can is on the far side. There's a little explanation as to why I've done what I've done. The bikers are flanking units, so they make the most sense going on the wing to go as fast as possible and outflank. These guys need to be in the middle because their guns are relatively short-ranged, but They don't need to be right up at the middle. These guys are my tanks, and he is an absolute beat stick, so they are going to do the maximum amount of damage. I put them in the middle allows that to happen. These guys are incredibly fragile, so keeping them at the back for me is important because I don't want them to die. This thing is very short ranged. Its gun is only a teardrop flamer template, which I'll show you when I come to fire it. These guys are pretty tanky. They're not as tanky. Oops, I've made an absolutely noobish error right there. You never put characters at the front of squads because in shooting, models at the front of the squad die first. So never put anybody important at the front of a squad. That's a quick lesson that I've taught myself. And then finally, I've mentioned about that, and my weird boy is attached to that squad because orc psychers get bonuses when they are in squads. So this is on the other side. So here is the opposing deployment and hopefully some explanation as to why. So let's just go through from this side. So we have the boys with the weird boy on this right flank. I nearly said left. On the right flank, Scorch, a flamethrower, killer can, the knobs, and the warboss. The warboss is not attached to a unit, unlike in my army. The blunderbuss, killer can, the bikers, the shooter boys, and then the grots at the back. Is there any particular reasons you wish to give me as to why you've gone with that, or is it just random luck?
Well, with the warboss, I didn't want to attach him to anything because I don't want him to slow down. On over here, I wanted the cycle of the large group, just mainly for protection, really. I've got this one at the back. They're not very strong, especially in this. And then with these guys, I know you put them right up wide, but I'm going to give them a little bit more sentry and just kind of rather than just copying you, just try something else.
Yeah, that's the one thing I didn't mention about the warboss. Because he's in mega armor, you can't use what we call the run move in the shooting phase. It's an option instead of shooting, you can try and go a little bit further forward. Warbosses in mega armor, or any model in mega armor, can't do that. And as a result, it will slow my knob squad down, but I don't mind that. You've gone solo because he's tanky enough to do it, and he will be able to still be useful without slowing the army down. So, because I deployed first, I would generally, as a rule of thumb, take first turn. However, we're going to play this like proper 40k. And in proper 40k, you can seize the initiative. Now, what that means is the player who's going second rolls one dice. And if that dice comes up as a six, that player takes the first turn instead of the person who deployed first. They basically steal the initiative. That's kind of where the rule comes from. So, if you want to roll that dice, do you want to go first? Well, I'm going first. Do you want to try and stop me going first?
Yes.
Okay, so you will roll that dice, and if it comes up a six, you will go first. And it's a five. So unfortunately, no dice for you. So I'll be taking first turn. I think to all my flatmates, I'm just going to pause the recording.
All right, so I got first turn, and now I'm going to take advantage of that. So first thing we do is the movement phase. And in the movement phase, kind of obviously, models move forwards or wherever they need to go. Most models, like infantry, like all of these guys, and vehicle walkers, generally as a rule move 6 inches. So I set my tape measure to 6 inches, and I'm going to move all my guys around. So I'm going to start by moving this guy forward, and then I'm going to move this guy forward. I'm going to come to them last. These guys, you can check ranges at any time. Like my guys here have a range of 18 inches. So if I have a look here, I can see I am just out of range of shooting at these guys. You probably won't be able to see that, meaning that I can't shoot them. So I'm going to go forward 6 inches, and then I will be able to shoot at them. In logic, anyway. I found as a rule, if you want to speed up the game, you don't have to measure the movement of every single model. Just get the first couple in the right place and just follow up the rest behind. These guys are going to go six as well. Now, my warboss is up at the front, which some people might be surprised at if they know anything about 40k, because he's at the front, he's the first one to die, but he has a 2+ save. I think he'll be fine, plus we have the lookout sir special rule, which is something I'll come on to in the shooting phase if it's applicable. I'm going to move these guys forward 6 as well, and then that will be pretty much everything, and I'll move my bikers as well. Just move these guys up. Now bikes are slightly different. Bikes can move up to 12 inches, the standard. Now I'm going to play it quite cautiously because I'm very, very scared of this flamer. So what I'm going to do instead is I'm just going to move them forward 6. I could have gone further, but I'm just going to move them 6. Play it safe, and then they can be a bit more rapid in later phases. Okay, the next thing that we have is the psychic
phase. Now, this is when the psychic guys, this is this guy, and on Ben's side, he's over in the corner, will manifest psychic powers. Now, when the psychic phase goes off, you roll one dice, we call them a d6, and you add the result of the d6 to the amount of mastery levels that your psyker has. That is how many spells he knows. And in our case, both our psykers know 2 spells. I actually forgot to generate them before the start of the game, so I'll have to do that in a moment. So, my psyker will generate d6 plus 2, and I roll a 3. I roll a 3, which means that I get 5 dice. Because I'm an orc, I'm in a squad of 10, I get an extra die, so I'll have a grand total of 6 to cast with. However, if I don't cast any powers, I will take some damage as a result. Now, Ben's psyker is the same level as mine, so his psyker does not get that bonus in his opponent's psyker phase. That bonus will go in his psyker phase, so he will get 5 dice to try and stop my psychic powers from going off. So I'm just going to pause the video, and then we will go over psychic powers and how they work, and then we'll cast them. So if you just want to... All right, psychic powers have been generated. I forgot to do that, so my apologies. You're supposed to do that at the start of the game. So we both use the Orc psychic power discipline. It's called the Power of the War. And I rolled my 2 dice. I get a 1 and a 2, as well as a power known as the Primaris power, which is the signature spell for that discipline. If you keep all your powers from one discipline, you get to keep it for free. So Ed Banger is a power that targets one model within 24 inches, and that model must take what we call a toughness test, where they'll have to roll their toughness or below on one dice. In our case, it's majoritively 4, or take a wound. If I roll well enough, I'm allowed to choose who the target is, but I'll explain that when I go to cast it. The second power I got is Warpath. This gives my unit, which in this case is this squad, plus 1 attack in close combat. Ben's rolled his powers as well. He got a power called Kill Bolt, which is a warp charge 2 power, so it's harder to manifest, but it draws an 18-inch line, which is pretty good, and everything under that line takes a strength 10 AB2 hit, basically allowing it to one-shot anything it hits, and even poses very significant threat to the vehicles. However, because it's a beam, it will hit everything in its path, and that includes his own guys. Or he may not be able to do it if he hits his own guys, I'm not exactly sure. And then a power called Da Crunch, which is a large blast template, which is a 5-inch diameter, and it causes a strength 2d6 AP4 hit on every model under the template, which means that you roll randomly for strength, and if it's high enough, you roll 11 or 12, the attack can be resolved twice. You roll again, and you get to do more damage. But that will come in his psychic phase. Right, so I should also mention the Primaris power. That is called Frazzle. It's 24-inch range, strength 6, AP3, blast weapon, which uses this slightly smaller template, which has a 3-inch diameter. It's not as big, but it can still do some reasonable damage and pose a threat to everything on the board with the exception of the war boss. So I have 6 dice. I'm just going to get those out of the way. And I'm going to start, because I haven't gone very far forward, the first thing I want to do is just check range. So if you could just set that to 24 inches for me. There is a lock feature as well. I'm sure you're aware of that. Yeah, a tape measure is an essential to any hobbyist in 40k, fantasy, Age of Sigmar, whatever you're playing. So from my weird boy at 24 inches will take me along here, and will, if I just check, it should also allow me to hit that killer can, although I think, yeah, I'm going to try that. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to manifest a power called Frazzle. I've already mentioned what this is, and you choose the amount of dice you want to use to cast the power. Now I need to, when I roll this, I will need to score 1, 4 plus or higher on these 3 dice. I could use any number of dice I want. I'm going to use 3. And if I get a 4 plus, the power is successfully cast. And I do. I get it with 2 dice. Now what that means is that if you wish to stop me from casting this power, i.e. you don't want me to drop a template on your Dreadnought's head, it shouldn't hurt it, but it's just a try, and it might scatter and do some damage because blast templates are not that accurate. You can roll any number of your dice, and for every 6 you roll, you negate one of my dice. If you can negate all of them, the power is stopped. You don't have to stop it. You can choose to let it through because I still have some dice that I have not used yet. So do you want to try and stop this, or do you want to let it through? You're going to stop it?
Yeah.
Okay, so you need 2 sixes to try and stop the power.
Can you use all 5?
Yep, you can use as many or as little as you like. So you need 2 sixes. And you get a 3, 3, 4, 6, 3. Okay, so the power is unfortunately still gets through when you've used your deny dice. So if I just quickly pass you this, I'm just dragging the killer cam along for a ride. And as I said, I'm going to be targeting the killer cam. So we place the template squarely on the killer cam's head, and we use something called the scatter dice. This means that the template is not exactly accurate. It may go off target. So I roll this, and I score a direct hit, which means that the template doesn't move. It stays exactly where it is, and the hit is resolved on the killer cam. It's strength 6, and the killer cam has a front armor, because it's a vehicle, of 11. This means that to hurt the killer cam, I need to score a 5 or higher. On a 5 plus, on a 5, I will do what's called a glancing hit. On a 6, it will be a penetrating hit. And I roll a 5, which means it is simply a glancing hit, which takes one of its wounds off. They're called hull points, but for ease, I'm going to refer to them as wounds. So it goes down to one wound. One hull point. It normally has 2. Most bigger dreadnoughts have 3. So it goes down to 1. Actually, I'm going to put that up there for the camera's ease. And that is the end of that power. And for my second power, just as an insurance policy, I'm going to put Warpath onto my squad. And that means I need 1 4 plus on these dice. And I get it with 2, which means that the power goes off. And this squad here now has plus 1 attack. So that is the end of the psychic phase. I hope that made a little bit of sense. It's kind of simple, and hopefully if we do it a few times, we'll be able to understand how it works. Right, so we're going to move on now, and we're going to go into the shooting phase. Now, I'm mostly going to interest, so we'll go with that. And this part is probably one of the most important phases of 40k these days. Shooting has become one of the most critical aspects of the game. So I'm going to start with my shooter boys, that is this squad over here, and they are going to shoot at they're going to shoot at the knobs. Now, these guns, these assault rifles, these shooters, are 2 shots each, strength 4, AP 6, with an 18-inch range, which means that if I measure 18-inch from this back guy, he is not actually in range, so he cannot shoot this round. This gun is slightly different, so I'll fire that separately. So I have 8 guys who are in range, which means I get 16 shots. So I go 4, 8, 13, 16. Once you're only up the first time. Now, orcs are terrible at shooting, but to do your shooting, you generally look at your stat line of your model, and you look at these stats under BS, or ballistic skill. This represents how good you are at shooting. To know what you need to hit, there is a chart in the rulebook, but you can also just simply do your ballistic skill taken away from 7. Now, my orcs are ballistic skill 2, and so 7 taken away 2 is 5, so I need a 5 plus to hit. And I get 1, 2, 3 hits. That's kind of bad. I was expecting 5 hits because laws of averages, so I'd kind of be probabilities a lot in my head. The second thing you do is you roll to wound. You compare the strength of the weapon to the toughness of the target. Now, the shooter is strength 4 and the knob are toughness 4. Because the stats are identical, you have a 50-50 chance, so I have a 4 plus to wound roll. And I score 2 wounds. Now, these guns are AP6, the knobs have a 4 plus save, which means that the weapon does not ignore their armor. So Ben, you have 2 4 plus saves you're allowed to. I don't know if you can hold that in one hand and roll 2 dice. There's 2 dice. So if you roll those. So we've got a 4 and a 6. I'll just pull those back together for the audience. Meaning that no wounds are suffered, your armor saves you, you take no damage. I'm not quite finished though. I have the big shooter. This is a slightly different weapon. It has 3 shots, strength 5, AP5. So I still need a 5 plus to hit, and I get 2. Now my strength is 5 and your toughness is 4, meaning that I am 1 higher, which means that I am wounding on a 3 plus instead of on a 4 plus like the normal guns. And so I score 2 wounds again. You then have a 4 plus armor save against this, and you fail 1. Now knobs are slightly tougher than normal troopers in that they have 2 wounds each. So the closest guy to the big shooter is this guy. And so he loses 1 wound. He goes down to 1, and that is the end of the shooter's shooting. The next thing I'm going to do is I'm going to fire the shooter on my warboss. He has not, this squad would normally I would run it, but because the warboss is in there, I can't run. And I'm going to take a pot shot at the I'm going to shoot at the warboss, and we're trying to put a wound on him early. So I hit on 5s, and I score 1 hit. Now, I'm strength 4. War bosses are toughness 5. Because your toughness is higher than my strength, I need a 5 plus to wound, which makes this harder. And I don't score a wound, so no damage is done with that. Next thing I'm going to do, I'm going to fire my war bikers over here. Now, their guns are also 18 inch range, so if I just check the range. And I'm going to shoot at this flamer killer cap. It's risky, but I think it's worth it. Now, these guns are basically big shooters with half the range and twin length that allow them to reroll to hit. So they have 3 shots each. 6, 9. And because they're an orc, they hit on 5s. So we have 2, 3 hits, but these weapons are what we call twin linked. This allows me to take any dice that missed when I roll to hit and roll them once more. Any more that come out as hits is great. I don't get to reroll any rerolls, so let's see what happens. And I find another 3 hits, so I get 6 hits in total. Now, these guns, like the big shooter, are strength 5, and the killer can, as I mentioned with the frazzle power, is armor 11. This means that I need to roll a 6 to do any damage to it. You do the armor value take away the strength is the roll needed to do any damage. On a 6, I will do a glancing hit. And I do not roll any 6s, so that attack was ineffectual. That is a fail. I'm going to run this squad forwards because they have warpath on, I'm quite confident in them, and I roll a 4. When you do a run move, you just roll a single d6, and that is how far they can move in the shooting phase. Some units can do it differently, but that is the general rule. So these guys are going to go forward an extra 4, just to try and bait out most of the damage. And I'm also going to run this killer can because its weapon only uses this teardrop template. So if I place that here, you can see it's not in range of anything, so I'm just going to run it because it works like infantry, and I roll a 6 so it can move forward another 6 inches. Goes forward like that. And then finally, I'm going to shoot with this guy. This guy has the Grotzuka, which uses, as I mentioned earlier, this 3-inch blast template. So I'm going to place it, and I'm going to target the shooter boys. The Grotzuka is 2 shots, strength 6, AP 5. So I'm going to place it on this guy's head. You try and place it to get optimal coverage, but I'm going to go with this guy. And you then roll for scatter. Now, I've rolled 11 and a scatter in this direction. Now, my ballistic skill is 3 because these guys are Gretchen inside walkers. So the actual scatter distance move is 8 inches, which if I just do it 1, 2, which means it's going to miss. It lands over here. So no damage done by the first shot. But it's a 2-shot weapon, so I get to do it again. And this time I score a direct hit, meaning I cause 1, I think I only get 2 hits out of that. Now this wounds at strength 6, it's 2 points higher than the toughness of the orc, and so it wounds on a 2+, and in AP 5, they have a 6+ save, so on a 2+, it will kill one orc. I roll 3 and a 2, so the 2 closest orcs, which is this guy and I think this guy, are killed. They're just straight up removed. They're dead. Nothing you can do about that, I'm afraid. And that is the end of my turn. I'm not in range to assault. I don't want to assault. So I'll take the camera and we'll go into Ben's turn 1. So first thing you do is your movement phase. I've already got that set to 6 inches. So you can just rock on and move your guys wherever you want to. Remember, your bikers can go 12.
Okay. Do you want me to explain my thinking?
If you want to, then absolutely.
I'm just going
to
move these guys forward.
All I'm going to say is the wounded guy, who is the guy with like the big skull on his back, I would keep him further back. No. This guy. This guy here took a wound earlier. Okay. So if he's at the back of the squad, he's less likely to die.
Okay.
It's just a thing to think about. The front models are always the first ones to take damage.
Now, I want to get the wizard of the
psyche. Yeah, psyche.
Yeah, out. What would you recommend?
Now, the beam power, as I say, draws a line and has an 18-inch range. So basically, wherever you want that power to go, you need to clear a path for him to fire that shot. So let's say, for example, you want to draw the line along here. You would have to make sure that there was nothing in this line for him to hit. So you'd have to move these guys out of the way. If you wanted to go here, you might want to clear this path. You want to go over here, you might maybe need to move the killer can out of the way. No, it just depends on where you want the power to go.
I want to go for your warpath.
Well, okay, so you need to be 18 inches away from him at the end of the move. Oh, so
I'll move the whole thing forward 6 inches.
Yeah, move them forward 6 inches, and then in the psychic phase, you can check if you're in range. You can check ranges at any time. So what I might do is get your tape measure to 18 inches and measure from my war boss towards your weird boy. So go from my boss towards your weird boy, 18 inches. So your weird boy would need to be stood exactly there for this power to work. Now, can he get there by moving 6 inches? You don't need to... Can he get there if he goes six?
Not in millimeters. Your call.
I think just because I'm being nice, I'll let you have this move. So if he gets to there and you can keep a clear path, then you'll be able to take that shot. Okay. But you will also want to make sure that there are guys in front of him, so like getting these guys along here, because otherwise these guys are going to shoot the living bejesus out of him. So move your weird boy six and then move the boys around to protect him. Now, normally I wouldn't be so nice as to give tactical advice to my opponent, but if you're trying to be friendly, you're trying to teach hobbyists to play, then this is the best way to do it, I have found. Now, the reason that I'm liking to do this is because Killbolt is strength 10. My war boss is toughness 5, meaning that if the beam hits him, he will die on a 2+. There is a rule called Lookout Sir, which I'm probably going to have to use, which will sacrifice one of my other dudes to protect him. But I'm very, very now concerned about the power of this power. So this should be fun. Okay, next movements.
I'm going to keep him here.
Okay.
That'd be a good thing, because obviously...
He's got the blunderbuss, he's a bit damaged. Yeah, he's got enough range to hit anything on the board. He'll be fine.
I'm thinking... What do I need to be thinking about what this is in range of, especially...
His gun has an 18-inch range, and he...
In terms of, like...
Getting into melee. If you want to... Well, guys move 6, and then assault 2d6, so an average of 7. So if you're within 13 inches at the start of the turn, you generally can hit combat. You can hit from up to 18 inches away. But considering the fact that you are within 18 inches of him, because I shot at him... But all of these guys will get to attack him before he gets to attack. Meaning there is a good chance I'll at least knock some wounds off and make it, even if he gets out of the melee, that he's quite likely to die, which is a risk that you might have to take. You may want to...
What would you do?
I wouldn't have put him on his own, but that's just me. generally, I would not be throwing him at anything that looks or smells like a power claw, because they're the only things that can threaten him. Honestly... Right now, because of where my power claws are, here, here, and here, and here, and this thing even poses a threat, even though it can't one-shot him, and he'll completely destroy it in return, you do have to be considerate of the fact that if he gets hit too hard, he will just fall over. Because he only has 3 wounds, even with a 2-up save, he might just die. But if he's camping, then he's not going to be able to do much damage. You can either go and try and kill this. You can go and try and kill them, although it's very, very risky. You'll probably get caught out in the open. Or you can play it safe, hide him, and then just move him forward with the rest of the guys and then bring him out when I come at you.
What about I just try and move this guy in front of him? Can I do that?
Yeah, you can shield him. Anything, because we use true line of sight, meaning that if I can't see past the killer can at him, I can't shoot at him.
And what do you think is my main threat?
This thing will absolutely obliterate that.
Yeah.
This will absolutely obliterate that, and this flamethrower is very, very dangerous, particularly to those guys, because of it ignores their armor. So I would be...
Is there anything I can do that's going to give me at least 3 more moves in terms of defense?
At this point, because the board is so short, playing defensively is very, very risky. Like, admittedly, if you stay exactly where you are, there is a good chance I can't assault you next turn.
Okay.
But... That is another turn where I can shoot at you, and considering I've already plinked that down to 1, I might kill it.
Well, I'll put this up there, and then it's going to kill that, but then I've got...
Okay, so you're going to play a shield, all right? Slide that forward. Bikers, they have a 12-inch move. Do you want to move those guys?
What advantage would I get from moving them?
Well, their guns are only an 18-inch range, so they're not very long range at shooting. And it would also give you a chance to bait me into going to an attack I don't want to go into. For example, if you go over here, I can't leave them alive. I have to kill them. Okay. And that is maybe that wastes the potential of these guys. I could be chucking them at something and just...
Can you take them out in one move?
Can I kill them in one shot? Unlikely. I can do some serious damage to them with something like this, but it's unlikely I could one-shot them.
So I'd still get another go with them attacking you?
If you roll well enough, yes. Okay. If your saves are good, then yes. Because you are toughness 5 for being on a bike, so you're a little bit more resilient.
So 12-inch
yep.
move?
Yep, up to 12-inch move. You don't have to go the full 12. Okay. And you measure from the front of the base, not the back. Right. So you've got a little bit more movement than you think.
Is it up to 12, sorry?
Up to 12. Maximum movement is 12. That's fine. That's fine. Think about it.
I think I might go.
No, if you were there, that guy could go all the way up to there. Okay. So, yeah, you're all right. Okay, you're going to go there. Shooter boys, are they going to stay where they are or are they going to move? Their guns are 18 inches, so they're not massively ranged, and you have just kind of...
Will these guys do anything to this group?
Well, it was these guys that shot those guys earlier, so in theory, yes, they can do damage. It's just you'll do it by weight of shots rather than anything else. You probably need to move into this gap in order to do it. You have a 6-inch move, not a 12. God, if boys move 12... And Storm Boys exist and they kind of suck.
So when you're playing, you know, like your proper games, experienced players, do you go just by feel or do you have a tape measure as well?
Sometimes we guess, but like because like you said with the weird boy, every millimeter counts. People would prefer you not, that you can guess your range if you want to, but if you're going to actually be testing, always have a tape measure or other measuring implements. Otherwise, your opponent will probably then say, that's too close. I think it's out. I think it's in. And while in casual gaming, you can do it. In competitive gaming, you should always have a tape measure to hand.
Yeah.
And plenty of spare dice because my squads can be rolling 120 dice at a time. It's stupidly scary. It's obscene.
Okay,
so now we go on into psychic. Now, as I did with mine, you roll one dice and you add your mastery level, which is, of course, 2. So roll one dice and you add 2. So you get 3, you add 2 to 5, and because you are in a squad of 10, you'll get an extra one, so you'll have 6 dice, and I am level 2 with 3 dice in the pool, so I will have 5. So your powers is the small blast, strength 6, AP 3, which will kill everything it hits except these guys, or except this guy, and will hurt these, as you saw. There is kill bolt, which is the beam power that you were setting up for earlier, and da crunch, which is the giant pie plate that drops on the heads, but it's only AP 4, so it won't hurt everybody. So what power do you want to go for?
I'm going to go for the beam.
Okay, well that's warp charge 2. That means that you will need, when you roll your dice, you can use as many or as few dice as you like, but you need to roll 2 4 pluses in order to cast the power. So how many dice do you want to use?
I'll use all 6.
You're going to use all 6, okay. It's risky. And he gets it with 3, okay. Now, I really need to stop this. So I don't have any way of boosting my save because I don't have a psyker in the squad. So I deny if I get 3 sixes. That, I wish my weird boy was in this squad right now, because that would have denied it. But the power goes off, and as we saw, we checked, it will just clip the war boss. So it hits automatically as a beam, because it's literally just a straight line of energy, and it wounds on a 2+. So one dice on a 2 up to wound. Anything but a 1. That's a 6. Right. Now, there is one thing I should have said that will save my war boss's life. Maybe. And it's called Lookout Sir. When a character is in a unit, so people like him or he is, you can throw other dudes in the way to block the shot. So he's an independent character. He can go anywhere he likes, like yours has. So on a 2+, one of my other guys will die. If I roll a 1, he is still dead. I roll a 6. So the nearest guy is this guy. So splat. Oops, I just smacked my girls. So this guy just gets completely vaporized because the war boss threw him in the way. But that's why generally characters go in units is because you can throw dudes in the way to protect them from the really big, scary stuff. Yeah, because like for example, if I had had that beam power, you would not be able to save him, whereas I've just been able to save him. Which it's a small thing. Like characters can work on their own, and mega armored guys probably can, but they lack what we call invulnerable saves, which is something I might talk about in another video. So with that done, let's move on to the shooting phase. So where do you want to start, and who do you want to shoot in the face?
gonna take a shot.
Okay. You have an 18-inch range, so just check each. So which is your target? Who are you shooting at?
Can I go with these bat guys?
Well, they're all one unit, so you'll be shooting at him, in essence. You'll be shooting at him.
Am I going to do any damage at all?
You'll be wounding on fours with a 2+ save, so there is a chance. And measure from him and go back 18 to see who's in range. Mm. So just swivel it round and just see, is everybody under that? I think they are. Okay, so you have... 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 guys in range. He's got a different gun, so we'll fire him separately. So each gun has 2 shots. You have 6 guys, and 6 times 2 is 12. So you have 6 dice there, and there's another 6 there. Now, as I said earlier, 7 minus your ballistic skill of 2 means that you hit on a 5+. What? What? Oh my... By the name of Gork and Mork, what the hell? 7 hits. Okay. Well, this just got interesting. So that's 7 hits. Now, your strength is 4, and the majority toughness of my squad, because he's a higher toughness than them, but you use the majority, not the highest. So their toughness 4, so those shots are wounding on a 4+.
Are you scared?
If you roll like that again, I might actually be scared. Okay, so that's 5 wounds. Now, I'm feeling brave, and I'm going to take all of those wounds on my warboss, because he's the first guy to get hit. I could look out, sir, but I'm not going to. So, 2+ armor save. And that's a 3, 3, 2, 2, and a 4, so I make all of my saves, so I'm fine. If that had been a 1+, I would have died.
So I haven't done any damage?
Yet. No. That's what a 2+ save is designed to do. And you have 3 shots with your big shooter, which is this separate gun. So that hits on 5s as well. And it misses completely. So no damage there. So pick a new unit, pick a new target, and unleash hell.
I'm going to... This one...
Has a flamethrower. So it only has that much range.
Oh, okay.
That one has the little small blast thing that I was using earlier.
Can I go over here? What's the range?
24, so you're in range. You can go anywhere on that squad.
I'm going to take on the
front guy. You're going to go on the front guy.
The
difference is that when you place a blast template, you try and hit as many guys as possible. Okay, yeah. So you can put it on any guy to try and get max. It's got to go on a guy to maximize the number of hits.
That's not going to count, is it? You're not going to take a front one out as well.
I think the best place to go would be on here, because you get 2 guys under that template. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think you get 2 there. So I'll hold that. So pick up the little dice with the arrows on it, which is over there, and then 2 more dice. They're your scatter dice. You have 2 shots, so just roll those and let's see what happens. So the first one is a direct hit. It goes nowhere, so you've caused 2 hits so far. And then you roll them again, because your second shot. And a direct hit again, so that is a total of 4 hits on the shooter boy. So 4 dice, and they wound on 2+. You don't need the scatter dice now. So it's 4 shots, wounding on 2s. That is 4 dead shooter boys. Boom. And there's nothing else that can shoot at them. So they are, if you take 1/4 of your squad dead in one phase, you have to take this thing called a leadership check. So you have to roll their leadership or below. Now, orcs are only leadership 7. Meaning that if I roll an 8 or above on these 2 dice, they run away. Come on. And I roll an 8. Now, orcs have ways to save them. Unfortunately, none of them apply because I have no characters, I'm not in melee, and I don't have a big enough squad. So they just run away 2d6 inches straight towards my board edge. I roll an 8, so they go back 8 inches. Actually, the flame is 8 inches long, I know that. So, and that takes them off the board. So they're all dead. Rip shooters. That's a kill point to Ben, and also a bonus victory point for the secondary condition known as First Blood, which means that Ben has now got 2 points to my 0. And I've just lost my shooter boys. Congratulations. So, next gun, you have your bikers left, you have the gun on your warboss if it's in range, and you have the ability to run any units you wish. And you can also shoot their pistols.
Can I take a shot at this guy?
Yep. Only things that are strength 5 can hurt him, so the only thing left that can hurt him is these dudes.
Yeah,
so you've got 9 shots, same as mine. I might actually lose this game now. I actually think I will lose this game now. Okay, so you hit on 5s. And if you do miss, you get to reroll all fail misses. Okay, so that's four hits so far. And then you get to reroll those five that missed. That was a... So there's reroll. And you get another two for a grand total of six hits. Now, you're attacking the vehicle, which is armor 11. So 11 take away 5 means you need sixes to glance. You roll two sixes, it dies. So it goes one whole point of damage. So it goes down to one whole point. That was scary. You've got run moves if you want to do it. You have shooting for your pistols if you wish to do that. And your warboss has an 18-inch gun, but I don't think he's in range of anything. You can check that.
Does it matter?
It does, because he's got to be able to see what he's shooting at. You can go a little further forward than that. You go from the front of the base. So, yeah, you are in range of that squad.
I'll do it.
Yep, you have two shots, and you hit on fives. And you miss. Mercifully, you don't have a custom Mega Blaster that gets hot. We're not playing Gets Hot. Then the only thing to do is, do you want to run either of those two squads? Do you want to run the Killer Can to make it go further forward a little bit?
Just in terms of, I'm thinking, should I move this forward? I'm thinking, should I move this forward? What can the, what in my next go, what will they be able to take out?
Or well, at the moment, they're designed purely to hit things in the face with axes and power claws. So if they're not in combat, they're doing absolutely nothing.
Okay. What about, you know, on your next round, are you just going to be able to obliterate them quite easily?
It's, well, these guys have got decent guns, but they don't ignore their armor. My best chance is to try and get this thing in with its AP4 flamer, but there's a chance that if you maneuver correctly, I won't be able to get into range.
And that's a 12-inch.
It's a 6-inch move and then an 8-inch flamer. So if you could, if you measured 6 towards them from the killer can, and then I could place the flamer.
Take 14-inch, right?
Well, yeah, it's 14-inch from there. So if, as long as you stay out of this arc, I can't touch them with the killer can.
All right, I'll move forward.
So you're going to run them D6. It's D6. One dice. And that's how far you move.
What, as in just...
Yeah, just one dice. So they move at 4.
They go from the front or from the base?
Yeah. Sometimes you can... You generally measure base to base with everything. Front of the base, the nearest point. So yeah, they just waddle forward. Keep that one next to him just to mark his wound.
I'm going to come back.
Put that wound on him. Yep, that's fine. Then you can run your killer can. You can. You have got pistols on your shoot on your slugger boys, but I don't think they're in range. They have a 12-inch range.
So in your game, would you allow people to keep checking ranges?
Yeah, you're allowed to check ranges at any time. That's the rules. You're allowed to check at any time. Most of those guys are not in range, so I don't think it's advisable.
Okay, we'll leave that.
We'll leave that there. Are you going to run your killer can?
Have I taken a shot?
No. Yeah, they did that. Yeah, so do you want to run your walker? Because it's not fired its flamer.
Yeah, why not?
Okay, so D6. Quick D6. You can probably just work this one out if you just roll it. 6 inches. Alright, so he gets a free waddle. Bear in mind that if it can't fit through that hole, it won't be able to go through that hole. Just a thing.
I've blocked myself up, but I didn't realise.
You might fit. I think the base just fits. So it's just... Yeah, it fits. So you can get through there.
Yeah.
You get through there. It's about 6.
Okay.
Okay, so that is the end of Ben's turn. I'm just going to go and get a drink because my voice is going a bit dry. And then we'll come back and do turn 2. Okay, turn 2 for me. In some games, you can alternate who goes first, but that's Age of Sigmar. This is 40k. We do things properly. Right. I've got a lot of thinking to do because I just got shrecked in that last round. So, priority 1 is going to be eliminate those bikers before they do what they just did to me. And I'm going to move my killer can like this to make sure that that happens. I'm then going to move my other killer can forward 6 inches. Just go down here. And then I'm going to stomp my warboss forward because I ain't afraid of no killer can. Oh, I am kind of afraid of that killer can completely one-shotting all my power claws. And I'm going to take a bit of a punt, and I'm going to send my bikers to try. This is probably going to be suicide, to eliminate this killer can right here. Because I need to get rid of them.
Urgently.
In terms of my slugger boys, I'm just going to send them six. I'm going to send them up here. And that way, if the bikers do die to the flamethrower, then I can just throw them in at the shooter boys. If not, I can use them to just mob down and tie up the bikers for the rest of the game. Sort of a double-edged gambit, really. Billy Pocrocks where they are, because they're just there to stay alive. And he's dead. So, we're going to go on now into the psychic phase. Roll 1d6, and because I still have a 10-man squad, I get plus 3 to this roll. I roll a 4, so I get 7 dice, and you get 6. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So there's your dispel pool, and I've got my carrot. Right, I have Frazzle, I have Edbanger, don't worry.
Sorry, I've got an extra one.
Frazzle, Edbanger, Warpath. I'm going to cast Warpath on 2 dice, so I get plus 1 attack onto this squad. And I do cast it. You have the option to stop it. If you want to try and roll 1-6 to stop it, you can. All it does, it means that they'll hit a little bit with a bit more damage this round. You don't need to use all your dice. You can use as many or as few as you like.
No, just got to hit 1-6.
Yep. So you're going to roll how many dice?
2.
You're going to roll 2 dice, needing 1-6. That's a 3 and a 4, so no luck. So they have plus 1 attack. Going next, I am going to cast... I'm going to go with Frazzle, and I'm going to try and cast it on that killer can, because if I do kill him, I then get a free run at the war boss. So I'm going to cast it with 3 dice. I only need 1 of these to go through. And I get it off with 2, so you would need 2 sixes to stop me, and you have 4 dice remaining. Going to go for it?
Yep.
Going to go for it, okay. And we get a 6, 1, 2, 4, no, doesn't stop it, so the power gets through. And we'll resolve that. I've got 2 dice to spare. And so, scatter dice. Place it on that killer can. Roll for scatter. I'll just write next to it. And that goes that way. My ballistic skill is 5. No, my ballistic skill is 2. Take that away from the 7 I've rolled. Means it goes 5 inches. So it goes over here and misses completely. No damage. And then my last 2 dice, I will cast Edbanger. And I'm going to target the... Well, a nice target. I've got the Ghostbusters theme tune in my head. Exercise thinking about it. No, I don't have line of sight. I've blocked it. That's annoying. I am not in range of them. So I'm going to try and cast Edbanger onto this squad. And I don't get it off, so nothing happens. So that's the end of the psychic phase. No luck there. Absolutely nothing happened, but they have plus 1 attack, which I need to remember when they throw themselves into melee. Right, shooting. This is going to win or lose me the game, I suspect. Right, so we're going to start with the easy bits. Have a flamethrower. Now, the flamethrower is strength 5, and the warbikers are toughness 5, which means same strength versus toughness means it wounds on a 4+. It's AP 4, and the bikers have a 4+ save, meaning it will ignore their armor save, meaning that on a 4+, a guy will die. So, 3, 3, 4, one war biker dies, ripping pepperonis. Bang, dead. That was quite easy. Okay, and then I'm going to shoot with these guys into the same squad. Now I have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 pistols, so I have 10 shots. 5, 9, 10. And because I'm an orc, I hit on 5s. That is 3 hits. Now, warbikers are toughness 5, as I mentioned, and pistols, just like the shooters, are strength 4, meaning that it wounds on a 5+. That is 2 wounds. It's AP 6, so you do get your armor save, which is a 4+. 4+ save. And you make them both, so you're absolutely fine. Right. That wasn't supposed to happen. I'm getting wrecked. Okay, bikers are going to shoot at this killer can at point blank range to try and kill it. 3, 6, 9 shots. Hitting on 5s, rerolling to hit. Quite good. That's 5 hits so far. And then another one for another 6 hits. Now, I need 2 sixes to kill the killer can. Other than that, it's going to survive. Come on.
No damage. No damage whatsoever. All right, fine, fine. I'm fine with that. I don't mind. Great. Right. Okay, right. Next up, the Grotzooka from this killer cat is going to drop its head on the shooter boys once again. And I'm going to go here, where it hits a total of three dudes. One, two dice. Scatter, 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 scatter. Where the heck is the scatter dice gone? Oh, it's there.
Yeah, sorry.
I'm blind.
It's hiding.
Place it there. And first one is a direct hit, so that's three hits so far. Second one goes 3 inches because I am a killer cam. I'm ballistic skill 3. So that basically flips it because this is a 3-inch diameter. I know I can just flip it over on itself, meaning it does hit my own killer cam. If I kill my own killer cam now. So 3 hits on the shooter boys, wounds on a 2, killing on a 2. So no 1, so 3 dudes die nearest to them. The closest to the firer dies. 1, 2, 3, ripping pepperonis. And then the killer cam is armor 11, so it is glanced on a 5+ because my weapon is strength 6. I didn't kill my own killer cam. Thank God for that. So that's fine. So they will now need to, both of these squads have taken some casualties, 25%. That's 3 out of 8, which is more than 25%. That's 1 out of 3. So they both need to take morale checks. Now, that squad, you need to roll 2 dice and you need to get 7 or below.
Oh,
yeah. Yeah, just anywhere you can see it. That's a 2 and a 5. So you pass your leadership check, nothing happens. These guys have the same leadership value, so you need to roll 2 dice, 7 or less. That's a 4. Okay, dice on the table, dice on the floor, we just re-roll.
Okay.
That's a 4 and a 3. You pass your leadership check again. So you're not running away. Your orcs are not cowardly. I'll go and get 9 dice.
You sure?
Yeah, I'll get 9 dice. Okay, well, that didn't go to plan. So, we're going to have to kill them the good old-fashioned way. Combat. So, how combat works is you roll charge distances. And this is quite easy. You roll 2d6 and that's how far you move. 2 dice and that's how far. Now, any model being charged is allowed to fire an attack called Overwatch. This is an out-of-sequence shooting attack that is resolved at ballistic skill 1. So, these guys are going to set the ball rolling and charge into this squad, meaning you get to fire Overwatch at them. So, each guy gets to fire with his full account of weapons, which is 3 shots each, and they... Only differences with these attacks is they hit on 6s rather than 5s after you. So you're hitting on 6s, here you go.
My dice skills are weak today.
Don't worry, you have one hand. So you hit on 6s, but you get to re-roll. Twin link, so you get 1 hit so far, and you get to re-roll all of those. So that's the second hit, and you are strength 5, I am toughness 4, so you wound on a 3+.
No, I don't have a problem. Okay.
3+, 2 wounds, I have a 4+ armor save, which I fail 1, so 1 guy is killed before he gets into melee. Rip. But then I roll 2d6 for my charge, I roll a 9, so I get into melee with you. And I'm going to do the same thing with my killer can. Now, when you're charging, you must charge the unit you shot. The only thing you're allowed to do is charge the unit you shot. You can't shoot at one and charge another. So killer cam charges in, rolls an 11. Nice big smack. Give me a hug. I'm going to rip your face off. Next thing I'm going to do is I'm going to charge these guys into that killer cam. They didn't shoot it, but I have nothing else I can charge. The difference with Overwatch is blast weapons like this cannot fire Overwatch. So you are just going to have to take this. And I make it in with a 7, I think. Yep, I make it in. So, splat.
Uh-oh, Spaghetti-O.
He will get a chance to attack, because these guys are only just strong enough. When these guys get attacked, it's ripped. Now, flamers are different on Overwatch. You don't place the flamer, but you get to fire a special thing called Wall of Flame, where you roll a D3, which is basically you roll the dice and half what the result is. And that tells you how many hits you cause automatically. So, I'm going to launch that charge, so you roll a D6 and half the score. So roll 1 dice and halve it. I'll tip it out of the way for you. So you roll a 5. We halve that to 2, but we round fractions up. So that's 3 hits caused on that squad that hit automatically. And as with my flamer on your bikers, it wounds on 4s, ignores their armor.
Mercifully, no wounds. So, charge, I hit him with a double one. I get don't get a double one. So, I hit you very, very hard in the face. We do that, and now we fight like proper orcs. Okay. Close combat is a little bit confusing because you have these things called initiative steps. Basically, this determines in what order everybody attacks. What I need to do now is pause the video so that I can check all the initiatives of all the dudes just so I know who attacks first. So if you could pause the video, we'll do some...
Okay, research done. So in terms of combat, I'm going to work from right to left. So we're going to start over here. Now, the fastest model in this combat is the Weird Boy. He has an initiative value of 3. The Killer Can, the Boys, and the War Biker have an initiative value of 2. And because of their power clause, the two knobs, the War Biker knob and the knob in the Boy Squad, are initiative 1. They're normally 3, but the power claw, at the cost of increasing their strength, slows them down. So they're going to be striking last. So the first model to attack is the Weird Boy, and he starts by piling in 3 inches. So he must get to within 2 inches of a model in base contact. So these guys are in base contact, so he gets in, he's within 2 inches of him, so he gets to attack. And he has 3 attacks basic, but he charged, and he has the Warpath power in effect. And when you charge, you get +1 attack. When you have Warpath on, you get another +1 attack. So he has a total of 5 attacks. And he has weapon skill 4. Your guys are also weapon skill 4, which means that they're the same stat, so I hit on 4s. And I get no hits. I suck at this game. That's annoying because he was killing on 2s. So that's a fail. So now everybody else attacks at initiative 2. So that's going to be this guy, and everybody but him and him, basically. So I'll let you do your attacks first. You have 3 attacks because you have a slugger and chopper, and you hit on 4s because you are weapon skill 4 and I am weapon skill 4 also. So you get 1 hit. Now, orcs are strength 3, and my guys are toughness 4, meaning that you are wounding on a 5 plus with that 1 hit.
So just one
yeah, hit. 1 hit, so wounding on a 5. So no damage done. And then all of my boys get to attack. Actually, I'll do the Killer Can first because that will probably do the most damage. So the Killer Can has 2 attacks basic and it charged, so it has 3 attacks. And it is weapon skill 2, and the Biker's weapon skill 4. Now, weapon skill is different to strength and toughness in that if your weapon skill is higher, you hit on 3s. If your weapon skill is less than half, you hit on 5s. So it's very rare that you're hitting on 5. So because 2 is half of 4, I still hit on 4s. And I get 1 hit. Now, I'm armed with a weapon called a Can Claw. I am strength 5. So Can Claw is over here. And it is +2 strength AP 2. So that 1 hit strikes at strength 7 against your toughness 5. That is 2 points higher, so it wounds on 2s and ignores armor. So that is a wound. So one biker straight up dies. So either you can kill him or put 1 wound onto him because he has 2 wounds. He's already attacked, bear in mind. So you can either kill him off or put a wound on him.
I'll kill him off.
You'll kill him off. Okay. So he's dead. So just keep him to one side so as we can keep track of combat resolution, like who died at what time. And then everybody was within 2 inches at the start. So when everybody piles in, they'll all get to attack. And they have 5 attacks each. No, they don't. Yes, they do. Because they have 2 attacks basic as orcs. They charged. Because they have a pistol and close combat weapon, they get an extra attack. And because of Warpath, they also get an extra attack. So Slugger Boys with Warpath hit very, 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 very hard. So I have 5, 10, 15, 20, 25, 30, 35, 40 attacks. I don't have that many dice on me. I'm going to need 2 hands, so
I'll just pass this over. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 19... Spell.
Over here.
Oh, yeah, 20. I'll do it in 2 lots of 20 because I don't think I'm going to need all of them. So, I'm weapon skill 4, you're weapon skill 4, I hit on 4s. That's a smattering of hits. Actually, that's quite a lot of hits. That's a lot of hits. That's 15 hits.
Okay. 15 4s?
Yeah, sometimes you get those crazy dice. And here's the difference. I'm wounding on 5s. Now, when you charge as an orc, you get +1 strength. So I got the strength 4. But the biker is still toughness 5, meaning that I wound on a 5+. Oh, wow. One, two, three, four, five wounds. Now you have a 4+ armor save and 2 wounds. So you need to roll 4 pluses out of 5 or die. I've seen it done. I've seen it done many a time. 1, 2 wounds taken, you die. Unfortunately, you almost passed, but you die.
These fake dice.
I've been accused of being many things with dice. Yeah, sure, come through. Yeah, so unfortunately, rip Warbikers. And when you get out of combat, the winning side usually gets to do something called consolidate. They're just moving 3d6 inches in any random direction they choose. My killer can gets to move a free 3 inches. I'm just going to turn it around to face the shooter boys and be like, dude, you don't mess with me. And my slugger boys are going to march forward as well. They're going to go 4 inches. And they're just going to spread out a bit because I'm kind of scared of that Grotzooka if it gets out of the melee with the war boss. So I'm just going to do that. And that's that combat complete. Rinse and repeat with the other two. So I'm going to go across. I'm going to go to here. Now the first models to attack are these two. This guy has what's called a big chopper. And this guy just has a chopper. So we're going to do them separately because they have different stats. So this guy has 4, 5 attacks because he has 3 basic, he charged, and he has 2 weapons. And he hits on 3s. Because my weapon skill is 4, your weapon skill is 2 because you're a killer cat. So I hit on 3s. 2 hits, that's dire. And I'm strength 5 because I charged. I'm normally 4, but I have plus 1 because I charged, so I'm 5. Your armor 11, so I need a 6 to kill you. I don't kill you. Next up is this guy. This guy has a slightly bigger axe, so he does more damage. But it's two-handed, so he only gets 4 attacks instead of 5. He hits on 3s. 3 hits. And his weapon is strength 7. Because it's plus 2 strength, plus 1 for the charge, means that it is strength 7. Your armor 11. I need a 4 plus to kill you. You're dead. It's a penetrating hit, but it cannot explode you or anything like that. So he just falls over dead. Paul rots inside, probably literally just wet himself because he just died. And then I get to consolidate. 5 inches. I'm coming to get you. No, it's okay. It's okay. You just might want to budge that.
It's alright. I can use it.
You sure?
Thanks. It's
alright. That's okay. Alright. And then we finish off with this combat here. Now, my guys cannot hurt you. Only he can. So he gets to attack, and then he gets to attack. So, I'll take that. Because I now have enough hands. And you have a total of 2 attacks, and you hit on 4s. So just 2 dice, 4 plus to hit. 1 hit, that's a hit. 2 plus to wound. That's a wound. So, 1 guy dies. Dead. And then I get to attack back. I have 4 attacks, and I hit on 3s with my power claw. That is 3 hits. And because it's a power claw, I get double strength and then get plus 1 as well because I charge. So I'm strength 9, meaning I need a 2 plus to do any damage to you. So that is a nothing and 2 penetrating hits, meaning you're dead. But this weapon is AP 2. This means it ignores all armor saves. And that means it may explode the vehicle. So if I roll a 6 with either of these dice, that explodes and sort of damages everything around it like an AoE blast. And I do roll a 6, so it explodes. So, dude, he made my squad run off the board on turn 1, so yes, this looks unfair now, but just think of the punishment I'm about to take. So, the explosion radius is... Oh, that's brutal. 6 inches. Ow! I'm sorry, man. I'm genuinely sorry. I did not expect to roll the triple 6, one after another after another. It's about it's since we got playing about an hour.
Oh wow!
Just 6 inches. Oh man, that's just sometimes that's 40k. So 6 inch explosion radius hits all of these guys. Hits my guys too. And then hits 1, 2, 3, 4, 5,
oh, no!
And the weird boy.
Is he a goner?
No, he'll only take 1 wound. He has 2.
Okay.
And it's only strength... It's strength 4 now. So my guys are wounded on a 5+. They're fine.
Your four guys are wounded on a 4+. One wound, you have a 4+ save against it.
Come on.
So this guy loses a wound. And then 5 boys who are wounded on 4s. 2 wounds, and again you have a 4+ save because I gave them heavy armor. And you're fine. And the weird boy is wounded on a 4. He's wounded, but he only has a 6+ save. You can't give him better armor. He's stuck with a t-shirt. So you need to roll a 6 or he takes a wound. He has 2, so you won't die.
Got 2.
No. He has 2 wounds, but you need to roll a 6. Unfortunately not. So he goes down to 1 wound, and then this is completely removed as a charred, smoking wreck. Baboom. I apologize profusely for that. I really genuinely do.
Is he dead?
No, but that hurt a lot.
No.
That hurt a lot.
I feel violated.
Oh, no.
I'm sorry, Ben. Right. Anyway, it's not over. You have a good chance to wreck a lot of my face this turn. Like, I put everything right up close, and there's a chance you'll get to do some damage back. So, we'll go now into Ben's turn 2. Thanks for your support, flatmate.
Okay, so...
movement first. You just move guys around to try and punch me in the face. Oh, he's dead. Splat.
Can I defend him? Is there
any... No. At this point, his best bet is to go in and try and murder something.
How can I attack him? Can we go, like, one-on-one?
There are things called challenges. Problem is, because you're on your own...
Yeah, screwed.
It just means that these guys would get to attack as well. They probably wouldn't hurt him because he's got 2 up save. But if you throw these guys in as well, these guys will fight these guys where you have the numerical advantage, and then those two will have to duke it out 1-on-1.
So do I need to move these to be able to do that?
No, yeah, they're close enough, and then you can just shoot them on the way in and then charge in. It's a 3-inch charge. You're not going to come up short because you have this little rule called here we go. So really...
Can these guys take these?
Yep, absolutely. Think about it. That's exactly what my squad just did to yours.
I don't think I need to move. Because when it comes...
All I'm going to say is that if I get in a good position, I drop a really nasty flamethrower. They just might want to reorganize.
But can I just try and finish him off?
Only the big shooter can do it, and it needs a 6 to go on. So you need to hit and then roll a 6 to kill it.
I was born risky, I would do it.
Hey, I like that sound. That is the sound of an orc player. Okay, so we're just going to stay exactly still?
Yeah.
Okay, so we're going to go into psychic now. You may have wanted to rearrange because you might want to beam my face off, but... Don't worry, if you want to move your weird boy around a tad, move your weird boy around a tad and just bring him like down here and zap my face off.
I'll bring it down. Oh, I'm looking at 2 inches.
Yeah, that's fine. You've got a 6-inch rabbit.
2 inches looks
fine. Yeah, that's fine. And then psychic, so you roll 1 dice and you add, you still haven't lost the model from that squad, so you still add 3 to this roll. I only add 2. That's a 1. So you get 4, I get 3. That's enough. That's still enough. So what are you going to go for? Beam, Pyplate, huge blast template, or are you going to go for the smaller blast that's a little bit more consistent?
What would you be doing in my position?
Well, that crunch, which is the big blast power, will probably do a lot of damage to these guys. Except him. He won't. He'll be fine. And it'll only realistically kill him because he's next in line.
Can I take all 3 out? Yeah.
No, because he's there, the nearest will be him, and then it's him. So he'll be the next in line, and then he'll take the hit.
I'll take it, it's fine.
So you're going to go with the big blast, the small blast, or the beam?
Beam.
You're going to go with the beam, okay? You can aim that wherever you want anyway. So you need 2 4 pluses to cast the power. And you get it. And I need 2 sixes to stop the power. And I don't get it. So the beam goes off. You can draw that line 18 inches anywhere you like. As long as you don't hit your own guys, because that would be silly. So realistically, your best line is somewhere down here. You can go through the war boss if you want to.
What will it do to him?
It will make me kill another dude to save him. This is exactly the same power as you used last time. Plus, you get a shot at him as well.
We'll do it.
Okay, so first one hits the war boss. He's wounded on a 2.
Single?
Yep, single dice. 2 up to wound. That's a wound. 2+ lookout, sir, or he dies. That's a 5. So I blast this guy and he dies. Then he takes the hit at strength 10, so he's dead on a 2+. But he's a non-independent character, he's like a sergeant, so on a 4+, I can save him. And I can. So he dies. But that is going to be a leadership check. And that's leadership 9 for the war boss. Which one did I roll? Was it the 2 or the 6?
Oh, I don't know. Which one re-roll?
All right. I should have really checked there was no dice down there before I made that roll. That's a 7. I make it. So I'm all right, but I've just lost half of my hitting power, which sucks. So that's a good psychic phase from you. All right, moving on to shooting.
This may be a stupid question. Can we remove him, or does he have to remain there?
If you want to take him off, he just gets in the way. So if you want to take him off, take him off. Generally, as a rule, dead vehicles stay where they are, but just for this, we'll take him off. It's easier.
Yep.
Okay, so shooting. Who's going to shoot where?
Will these guys finish him off?
Only that gun has a chance. Hits on a 5, wounds on a 6. You have 3 shots.
Okay, we'll do it.
Okay, 3 shots. Hitting on a 5. Your insane rolling earlier means that there's a good chance this might actually go through.
No.
No hits. That's unfortunate. And those guns are not strong enough to hurt it, I'm afraid. Okay. And you can't hurt it in melee either because armor 11 and strength 4. Next to Cobalt of Core will probably be to shoot him at these because that's what you're doing, I'm guessing.
Yep.
So 2 shots. Or you can use your one use only flamer. Which will cause 2 hits and wound on 4s, and it's more consistent because you will be in melee and dead next round. So you're going to go with that, okay? So, force to wound, because there's no majority anymore. Two hits. So, force to wound, because there's no majority anymore, you just use the highest. So, force to wound. No wounds. That's unfortunate.
For me.
Yeah. Although, to be fair, I'd have probably tanked it anyway. And then these guys, there are... three pistols in that. No, it should be 2. No, the chopper is supposed to be the big chopper. There's 4 pistols in that squad. You can shoot at those if you're going to charge in, or you can try and charge these guys.
Can I do any serious damage to this?
Well, apart from meaning that this guy is forced not to attack him, because if you shoot at them, you'll have to merc them in melee. But I think these guys can probably merc them in melee. Okay, so that's 4 shots hitting on 5s. Yeah, that's no hits. This is the problem with orcs. Their shooting is terrible. And then these guys are going to probably put their pistolas into these, I'm assuming.
Yep.
So that's 10 shots. Hitting on 5s. Fine, it's a 6. Wowzers. I think you're a dice short there. No, it's just around there. Okay, so that's 5 hits. And then you wound on 5s as well. No wounds caused. That's unfortunate. The Grots could do some shooting. They probably won't do anything, but they can shoot. They hit on 4s, wound on 6s.
I'm not even going to bother.
You're not even going to bother. Fair enough. Okay, so that's shooting done. Now for charges. So who's going to charge and in where? Well, I would advise you start with this guy, because otherwise I'm just going to drop a flamer on their ass and they're going to be in trouble.
Let's do it.
Okay, so I will use my flamer because I have no real other choice. D3 shots. And I roll a 3, so I halve it to 1 and a half. Add 1 gets me up to 2. So it's 2 hits, and they wound on 4s. 1 wound, you have a 2 plus save. You're fine. And that charge is basically anything but double ones, and you'll be fine. You're in. Smack. These guys have to charge them because they shot at them. Yeah. So that's probably about a 4-inch charge. It's 2 dice. To be fair, unless it's like you roll a 3, I don't think it will matter. Nope, they're in. So they just come in and they smash me in the face. Really, really hard. The 2 wound counters are on this guy and this guy. And then these guys can charge them if you want to.
Yep.
Okay, I'll fire my Overwatch with my guns. I hit on 6s, but it's twin linked. No hits this time. Try again. 1-6, wounds only 3. For 1 wound, 4 plus save. 4 plus save, single dice, and so you lose a guy. But that's still only about a 4-inch charge, so 2 dice. You're in. That's not a win count. So they just go thundering into the bikers.
Is this guy have to come?
Well, you either keep him in the squad, or you could have detached him when you did the psychic move. You can leave him out if you'd rather. He will go first, though.
Yeah, I'll detach.
Okay, you're going to detach.
If I put him in, will he go last?
No, if he goes in, he will go first, but I could... there'd be no risk to him going in. All it would mean is that if you lose, by some miracle, he will die if I chase them down. It's a small risk, but...
Okay.
You going in?
Yeah, I'm going
in. He's going in. Okay. So, there's no point charging there because that shot didn't work. Oh, it's fallen off. It's fine. It's fine.
Well, he is damaged, so...
Well, yeah, but he hasn't lost his gun. Do you want to start there or do you want to start there?
Let's start here.
Okay, so your weird boy goes first. He has four attacks.
Is this part of this?
No, that's not a wound count. So you have four attacks and you hit on fours. But two hits. And now weird boy is strength four, but he charged. So he's up to strength five and his weird boy staff is plus two strength. So he's strength seven at the moment, AP four. So he kills on twos. That is one wound. So splat that guy. He's dead. And that's that. So now all of your guys get to attack. So that's going to be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 32 attacks.
Yeah.
Yeah. Imagine if you had a squad of about, I don't know, 300 of these guys. How many dice you'd be rolling? I don't think there's 32 dice in the box. But just get about...
I've used 2 dots of 16.
Yeah, do it in 16s. Okay.
I'm lost counting. 1, 2, 3,
4, 16. Okay, and you hit on fours. Yeah, that's a hit. That's hit. Hits. That was a miss. I flipped that over. There hits. Yep. Okay. So there you go. That's a huge amount of hits. And now you wound on fives because I'm a biker. I'm toughness five and your strength four. That's one, two, three, four wounds. I have two wounds and a four plus save. So if I fail two of these, I'm dead. And I fail all of them with a quadruple one. What's the odds of that? 6, 216. That is a 1,296 chance of that happening.
Oh, sorry.
One in 1,296 chance that I rolled that. 6 to the power 4.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, they're dead completely. That's another point to you. So your score now goes up to 3. In terms of anyone who's keeping count on my side, I have killed 2 slots of killer cans and the biker, so I am also on 3. It's still level. Right. And in this combat, I'm assuming we're having a duel. I'm guessing.
Yeah.
We are. Okay. So in this combat, so these guys will fight them and they'll fight each other. So we start here. This guy goes first because he's got a slightly different weapon to these two. So he goes first. He has 5 attacks. 5. And he hits on 4s. So that's 3 hits. And he wounds on 3s. That's 2 wounds. I have a 4 plus save and 2 wounds. I pass one of them, so I go down to 1 wound. Next up, you have these two dudes because they've got slightly bigger axes. They have 4 attacks each because their weapons are two-handed. 3, 4, that... It's 8 in total because the power claw is even different again.
Ready?
Okay, so you hit on 4s. And your strength is now 7. Because you have a plus 2 strength weapon, so you wound on 2s. 2 wounds. I have a 4 plus save and 1 wound left. If I fail either of these, I died. I died. Ripperoni knob. That knob is dead. So that's another point to you, taking you. It's 4-3. And this combat is still one big combat, but that means that next round, if this isn't done, they'll get to attack him as well.
Okay.
So these guys are identical. But you charged. So I have 4 attacks. You have 5. We both hit on 4s and we both kill on 2s. So you go first. You hit on 4s. That's 4 hits. 1 in 1,296. Quadruple 1, please, or I die. Never mind. So my war boss dies, but... They're the same initiative step, so they both get to attack. So I hit on 4s. 2 hits. I need 1 2 plus. 1 in 36 chance of you living. He's dead. There's a 5. There's a 2. So...
But we're both.
Boom. They kill each other. Kind of expected, really, unfortunately. So that's both 2 points to both sides for a kill point and for Slay the Warlord, which is our secondary objective of killing the bosses. Meaning that it is now 6-5 to Ben, and you win that combat, so you consolidate d6 inches in any direction. So just roll the dice, and that's how far you get to move. So you get a free 5-inch move wherever you want to go. Well, this game is actually really spicing up. I don't know which way this is going to go. I honestly don't. This is kind of cool. Mm-hmm. But you remember what we were saying? I was completely wrecking his face when you came in.
Yeah.
Now look at it. My entire flank has just completely capitulated. Okay, so I need another drink because my throat's gone sore again, and we'll come back and we'll do turn three. All right, it's currently 6-5, as I mentioned, and we're going into turn three for my orcs, the orange squad versus the blue squad. I'm literally playing red versus blue here because I picked all my boys in orange and your boys in blue. I didn't even realize I'd done that. Right, anyway, so I need to rip some faces in, and the problem is my killer can can't hurt them. Well, it can, but it's risky. Right, shuffle. Oh, God, this could be a disaster if this goes wrong. Right, easy kill. Take the easy kill. Get the grots. Google no copyright strike for my awful singing, please. Right. Okay. Psychic. Both our psychics are alive. My squad is now less than 10. So I don't get the bonus dice anymore. Neither will you, because you lost one guy to Overwatch. So I get 3, and you get 3 also. And I'm going to play it quite safe. I am just going to go with... Oh, God, what was my other power? I am going to go with Ed Banger onto that squad. It's just one. I'm going to use one dice to do it. And I don't get it off. It's a fail. And I'm going to get Warpath onto my squad again. And I get it off with 2, so you need 2 sixes to stop me. Unfortunately, there's no 6 there, so they have plus 1 attack once again. Right, into the shooting phase, and I'm going to try and flamethrow at you. I can get 3 hits there. I can't get 4, no matter what I do. And it's strength 5, toughness 4, like on all orcs, with a couple of exceptions. So it wounds on a 3+, ignores your armor save. That's 3 wounds. Now, knobs have 2 wounds, and the closest guy dies first. So, he takes 2 wounds and dies, and he's the next closest and dies. Because he's already lost one. So, those 2, unfortunately, are just flat dead. And they will now need to take a leadership test at the end of the phase, but we'll do that, as I say, at the end. So, I'm going to put some pistols into that squad. I have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 of those. 4, 8, 9... And I hit on a 5+. No hits at all. God, even grots wouldn't have hit that. And then I'm going to use my blast weapon. I'm going to put it onto the Gretchen. So I just pass this over so that I can maneuver the blast template for things. 1, 2, 3, mercifully. Okay. So I'm going to place it there. Hits 5 guys at the moment. And I roll for scatter. And I score a direct hit with the first shot. And with a second shot, also a direct hit. That's really cruel. That's 10 hits in total. Your strength 6, your toughness is 2. Grots are appalling at staying alive. 6, 10. So on a 2+, a grot dies. And I have 10 hits. I do have 10 by then. So 7 grots die. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. They're just gone. The heavy caliber ordnance. Woohoo. Okay, that's all of my shooting. So you've got a couple of leadership checks. The first one is on these guys. 2 dice, 7 or less. Made it. And the run herd is also an orc, so he's leadership 7 as well. So it's 7 or less, or the grots will have a problem. And you roll a 7 again. Every single morale check on a 7 makes it again, so nobody runs away. Well done. Right, so in terms of some charges, we have a couple. I'm going to throw my killer cannon to here, even though it's probably suicide. I need 2 dice. And I get it with a 10. So I hit you very, very hard in the face. Look at that. And then these guys are going to charge there. You do get Overwatch, though. So you have 2, 4, 6, 8 shots from your shooters. I've given you... How many you got there?
I've got 8 now.
Okay, you've got 8 now. So these shots will hit on 6s, because when you are on Overwatch, your ability skill immediately drops to 1, no matter who you are, unless you're a weapon. So that is just the 1 hit, I'm afraid. But it wounds on a 4. Causes a wound, I have a 4+ save, and I die. So
So I lose a guy. It's fine. You get three shots with your bigger gun as well, which hits on sixes. Gets a hit, wounds on three, because it's strength five. That's a wound, and I have a 4+ save again. And I lose another guy on Overwatch. So two die, and then I go and make the charge, and I get it with a 7. Bang. Bang. All right. So we'll go here first, because this is actually going to make you smile. So this guy gets to attack first. He's initiative 3, he's initiative 2, he's initiative 1. So he goes first, and he has 3 attacks. He hits on 3s, and if you can roll, then roll a single 5+ from there, I die. So 3. 2 hits. Either of these is a 5, I'm dead. Double penetrating hit, and because he can't make it explode because you're not AP2, he's dead. Taking it to 7-5 to the blue team. Hopefully, we're going to redress that right about now. So, Weird Boy piles into this combat. He is initiative 3, so he's slightly faster. And again, I put Warpath on, so I have an extra attack. So I hit with 5 attacks. Weapon skill 4 versus weapon skill 4, I hit on 4. That's poor. 2 hits. But I am strength 7 because I have a Weird Boy staff, which is +2 strength, just like your big axe. So I kill on 2s because I'm AP4. So one guy dies. 1. And then everybody else gets to attack except him. So you will have 2, 4, 8 attacks with your guys. So that's 5 there. 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. And you hit on 4s. And that is a lot of hits. That's 6 in total. Now bear in mind, because with the same initiative step, anybody you kill still gets to attack. You wound on 5s because you're strength 3 basic. 2 wounds get through. 4+ save. I'm rolling appallingly for my armor save. I lose another guy. But he still gets to attack. So that's going to be 5, 10, 15, 20, 25, 30 attacks.
Is he dead yet?
He will be dead, but he still gets to attack, so I'm just leaving him there to keep... I'm just keeping count of the score. So that's 5...
Get some close-up action.
10, 15. I'm doing 2 lots of 15. All right, I hit on 4s. Oh my days. That's poor. That's 6 hits from those, and I wound on 4s because I've got +1 strength for charging. That is 4 wounds. Now, annoyingly, shooter boys, because they didn't pay for the armor upgrade, I ran out of points, only have a 6+ save. So if you fail all of these, don't roll a single 6, your squad is dead.
Okay.
Sorry. A 1 in 2, 16, and then that. So, unfortunately, those 4 guys are now dead. Shooter boys are dead. The score goes to 7-6 to the blue team, and I consolidate just a meager 2 inches. He's dead as well.
So, wait, you're reds, right?
Yes.
Yeah.
So you're winning 7-6. Okay. And now it is your turn to try and use what you have left to kill my guys. And so realistically...
Objective here is get these probably... Oh, I don't know.
I've got my plan.
You've got a plan. Sure. You'll stick to it. Tape measures by your left if you need it.
Movement.
Yep. Movement indeed.
6 inches.
Indeed. That's the same plan I would have used. Sorry about that. Quick memory glitch. Ran out of space. So Ben's just going to move the rest of his guys up right about now. Nope. It's fine. It's fine. It's fine. It's okay. They're not fragile like splitty space elves, stupid Eldar trickery. And then what are these guys going to do?
These are going to move.
Okay, you're going to move the grots. Where to?
6 inches as well.
Yep, up to 6. Oh, you're going to try and shoot at the boys. Okay. I think I'm just going to be a killer can carry this one.
Can I
move them?
Can I move these in?
Yep, you can go into combat in the assault phase, but you'll get the shoots on your way in as well.
Right.
But they do have an extra attack, so we'll probably mob you down.
Are these going to be able to reach it?
Oh yeah, they get a move and then they can charge. So absolutely.
Right, we go.
Okay, so you're going to move up. Just with these guys, just to make sure the charge is easier. Just like you can get within 2 inches, and then you're guaranteed to make the charge.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so psychic, you do still have a couple of powers. So roll a d6 and add 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Yep, just add 2. So you get 4, and I get 4 also. There's 4 dice. 3, 4. So, do you want to go with the beam, the large blast, or the small blast?
Are either of them going to reach here?
The beam has 18, and the blasts have a range of 24. I'll sort that out. I think it's 24 anyway. The big one or the small one?
Big one.
The big one, all right. So this is a warp charge 2 power. So with your 4 dice, you'll need to roll 2 4 pluses in order to make the power go off. You could also drop it on the grots if you'd prefer.
No, go drop it here.
It's the bigger one, sorry. I should have got the large blast out in advance. Excuse me. Sorry. Oop, light glitch.
I'll get it.
It's okay, I need to put it down anyway. This, oh boy, the crunch is a huge power. I'm going to get that dice on. Okay, so.
It has to go from the middle.
Well, you need to cast it first. So you need 2 4 pluses to get this power to go off. And you get 2. Now, I have a psyker in the squad you're shooting at, which means I get +1 to my deny the witch stop rolls. So I need 2 5 pluses to stop this power. I don't get it. So the power goes off, and you can place the large blast anywhere on that squad. I would recommend as far away from them as possible, because it will brutally murder them.
There?
It's got to be on a dude. That's the only rule. It's got to be on a dude.
There?
Okay, I'm going
Does
there.
Does that take your psych out?
Yeah, there? That... I don't know, but it will scatter as well. So, first thing you need to do is roll how powerful the blast is. It's weird. Its strength is 2d6. So roll 2d6, and that's how powerful the shot is. And he rolls a 7. So the shot is strength 7. Now you need to roll for scatter with the scatter dice and the 2d6, so it scatters 2d6. And that is a 4-inch scatter. So from this guy, that's going to go to about there, which just clips the one dude. So that's a 2 up to kill him.
What?
2 up to kill. Dies on a 2+.
One?
Yep, just the one. So one guy dies instantly. Splat. On more red team member dead. That's 4 less attacks coming your way in the combat round, which is not too bad. So that's your psychic over. Let's move on now to shooting. What are they going to do? Are they going to run, or are they even in range to use their pistols? They're not in range, so you may as well run them.
Run.
Run. Yeah, you roll a d6, and that's how far they get to move in the shooting phase. And you roll a nice juicy 5. So they actually, I know a blast template is 5 inches long, so just move into the top of the template, just to there. Yep, it's about there. Eek. Man, this is going to be so close. I think you're gonna, I think you'll win by virtue of first blood here. I think. Okay, so shooting. Those guys have some guns, and these guys have some guns as well.
Can these do anything?
Yes. They have 1 shot each. Strength 3, AP nothing. So they'll be wounding on 5s, but they hit on 4s. So. If you want to wash out, it won't be too loud. It'll be fine. It's okay. Go for it. Sorry. You hit on 4s. 3 hits. Wounding on 5s now, because your gun is quite puny. For 1 wound, will the grot actually kill an orc? This has not actually happened to me ever. Oh, balderdash. Splat goes the orc. Actually, yes, I have. I had a meganob killed by grots in Ghost Combat. I rolled a double 1 for his armor save. So yeah, grots kill a guy, and he has a pistol as well. So he hits on a 5, just a single shot. And he misses. And then these two both have a pistol they can use. Hits on a 5. Or no hits, unfortunately. Okay, and now for charges. Now, they've run, so they're not allowed to charge, as tempting as it is. But you get to charge into here. I have some Overwatch. I have 4 pistols.
Hi, Ellen.
Hi.
So, these guys hit on 6s. Ooh, 2 hits. Okay. Wounding on 4s. 2 wounds. 4 plus armor saves. And you make them both. So now roll your charge, and you get anything but a double 1.
Okay.
Anything but a double 1.
Yeah.
That's not a double 1, so you hit me in the face. Whoop-ow. Okay. And then we'll just fight that combat. Now, my weird boy is the same initiative as your guy, so they'll attack together. So he'll go, and he'll go. So you go first. You have 4 attacks, and you hit on 4s. That is 2 hits, and you wound on 2s, because you're strength 7. So, okay, I have a 4 plus save. And I fail them both, so I lose 2 guys. So 2 guys die there, and now my weird boy gets to attack. He has his 4 attacks because of Warpath. So he hits on 4s. Not good. And he wounds on twos as well, because he's strength six. Two wounds, so he kills him in retaliation. I think he was already wounded, but it's fine. So that's two wounds to two. And then this guy gets to attack, because he's the only guy left. He has his four attacks, because he has warpath and two weapons. And he hits on a four. He gets three hits. But he's only strength three, because he hasn't charged. So he is wounding on fives. No wounds. And then the two power claws go. So your guy gets his four attacks. And my guy gets his four attacks. And they go at the same time. So even if you do kill my dudes, go for it. Yeah. You're hitting on fours? Three hits. If you roll all two pluses here, you kill them all. So you wipe the squad. But you also die. So everybody dies. So that's another two kill points to you, taking you to nine. And one for me for killing the squad, taking me to... Seven. So it's 9-7 now to the blue team. I mathematically can't win. I've lost. Oh, I don't believe it. Okay, right. Turn four. This should be pretty quick. I've got one thing worth doing.
Right. Hold this, please. Grot warfare. Engage. 6 inches of movement.
Of what?
Come on.
Oh, he has all but mathematically beaten me now.
Oh my god.
All but.
It's 8 years of experience.
Yeah, this is bad dice, bro. Bad dice.
What's it?
Yeah, Workman blames his tools, and to be fair, I blame my dice. I always blame my dice. And to be fair, I did do some stupid things. I was a bit more on at times. Anyway, shooting. I'm in range. Sweet. Okay, nice juicy target. There's four there. Ooh, that's even five. Sweet. Okay, so rough scatter. That goes 6 inches. From this guy, 6 inches forward is to there. So that's two hits. Second one. Here's a direct hit. Seven hits. Two, three, four, five, six, seven. And that wounds on twos. So that's six wounds, and you have a four plus save against that. Oh my days. Makes five of them. So only one guy dies. Oof. Ooh, that hurts. Okay, so Grot, I've got two guys in range because I don't want to get too close. Hitting on fours. No hits because my Grot's terrible. And I'm going to concede. I lose. Well played. I'm there. GG, That is a victory for the blue team. Ben, not sure how, but I lost. I blame my bad morale checks and your good morale checks, because my guys ran off and yours didn't. Cowardly bloody shooter boys. So there we go. That is hopefully a bit of a teaching 40k bat rep for all of you. I hope that was informative. I hope you enjoyed the game. And I hope I don't get slated too much in the comments. I'm just going to say I let the new beat me first time luck. Right, so that will wrap up today's video. We're going to hopefully do a little sit and talk discussion, explains like how informative the game was, whether the game will want to be played again. I know you said you're not interested into the hobby for the financial reasons, I understand that completely, but maybe just about getting into the game casually, maybe just playing a few games against whatever. So, thank you very much for watching. I hope you enjoyed the video. My name is Michael for Tactica Imperialis with Ben, and until next time, we'll see you all again.